Just this week, I received a heritage hymnal compiled by Church of God Hymnal Committee. And most of the songs that are in the heritage hymnal are in this beautiful hymn book that we have here that the Lord wanted us to have. Sometime, perhaps in June after the revival meeting, or an appropriate time, I would like to bring all of you that don't have the Church of God background into a worship experience, an appreciation of a singing people. The Lord wanted us to continue, even though the church as such is a non-denominational fellowship. Many of us here have a wonderful Church of God background. These hymns, many of them, or these gospel songs, are songs of personal testimony and of victory. They're songs out of deep commitment and vision and suffering. One of the most wonderful songs that's in here, written by the chief songwriter in the Church of God for so many years, Barney E. Warren was his name, is a song you find on page 274, and it's entitled "The Ways of Devotion." Some many years, as the camp meetings would come and go, I enjoyed this song just about as much as any song that was ever sung. It is a great and wonderful and glorious song. Let's turn to number 274 as we all stand together. Waves of Devotion. A glorious blessing bestowed upon me, salvation, the joy of my heart, the theme of my song. To me the rich graces impart.
The rich devotion are blood in my soul. more priceless than
rubies or gold.
His blood is on the
heaven.
He's filling my heart
with his treasures of gold.
I'm feasting with him from above.
The waves of devotion are flooding my soul, and sparkles so bright in the sun. I drink of that fountain of glory and hope. My evening on earth has begun.
Oh my goodness, sing that last verse all the way through a cappella. It sounds so wonderful. Now, one of the great things about these songs is that many times they sound better in a cappella than they sound otherwise. And see, as they would roll in with the buggies. See, Warner did a new thing. They thought, you know, some of us accused Brother Helm of doing a new thing because we travel in company and in singing companies. But Warner did that. Years ago, it says they sang in the stations, they sang in the train stations, they sung in the hotels, but mostly when they would go into a village in carriage, two or three carriages, they would go in singing. Warner would tell them to sing with all their heart. And they would sing in such beautiful harmony that they'd go up and down the village singing. It was a rather new phenomenon for most people. There wasn't many rejoicing hearts in any city. And they would sing up and down and drive up and down. And then after they'd gathered a sufficient crowd, Warner would announce the meeting would take place at a certain place. And they'd disperse. But see, they gathered people by the joy of the song. We did that in St. Mark's Square. Because we were singing Precious Assurance, Jesus is Mine, Amazing Grace. And boy, they just poured out of the shops in the various places. And we didn't announce any meeting, but we had one right there. And it just drew people so preciously. So this song, you know, being sung a cappella is much like it was. The joy of it, I feel, in years gone by. Our pitch again. All right, a cappella, more precious. More precious. Number 54, an old hymn. It's most beautiful. Fairest Lord Jesus, ruler of all nature.
Yeah.
Ye are the salt of the earth, and if the salt hath lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. And Pastor Steve was sharing with me this afternoon, after reading the preaching of Martin Lloyd-Jones, that where Jesus said that ye are the light of the world, that ye is in the emphatic tense, meaning that ye are the light and the only light. Our song has just said that Jesus is the light, and he's that. And yet Jesus turned to us and said, ye are the light of the world. And you're all the light that God has today. So let your light shine and let it not be hid. The joy of being in these services today is to see the beautiful light of God. For if we compare ourselves to the sun or moon, we have to compare ourselves to the moon, for it reflects the light of the sun. And we're the moon reflecting the beautiful light of Jesus Christ. Years ago, when Kathy was around 14, 15, 16, right in those ages there, somewhere, the thing I would notice about her would be that there would be such a reflection of Shekinah light. And in those days, I would marvel in the pulpit over where the basketball, where the gymnasium is now, I would marvel and I would feed from such beauty and such love, because it'd be reflected, the light of our Lord. It'd be such a heart of earnestness and a heart of willingness. Moses prayed in the 9th Psalm that the beauty of the Lord would be upon his people and upon their children. What more can we ask for than for the light of God to shine forth as a beacon to give men a hope in this age? To my delight and joy, Brother and Sister Morgan here with us tonight, they told me that God blessed so wonderfully Wednesday night, I believe it was, when Brother Morgan was here. And it's such a wonderful privilege to have them both here with us tonight. This is Terry and Kathy's, I could say former pastor, but Brother Bob and his wife became our pastors many years ago. We've never given him up. So he's a pastor of pastors. Therefore, with that regard, Kathy and Terry and family don't have to give up anything. And they know that this is true. We're just so glad that they're here. We pray that as he leads us in prayer, that our hearts may be caught up with him. If you'll take this microphone here, Bobby, thank you so much. And bring it to Brother Morgan. He'll lead us in prayer before we continue with the service. Let us pray.
Father, we come rejoicing in Jesus over these beautiful songs that we've just sung. And we marvel, Lord, that you are a God of beauty, that you want us to be beautiful, that you've created beauty and want it in our hearts and on our faces and in our lives. Oh, God, we think the devil takes and destroys and makes things ugly, but you take them and make them beautiful. We love thee for this. Thank you for this privilege to be here tonight. Thank you, Jesus, for your sweet presence. Thank you for the blood. Thank you for the cross. Thank you, Jesus, for the victory of Calvary. We're thankful, Lord Jesus, that you love us tonight. You died for us. You're living to keep us. We rejoice that Jesus Christ is here tonight, the living Lord, not a dead Christ, but a living Christ, one that lived, died, buried, rose again, is now living, interceding at the right hand of the Father for us, and through the power of the Holy Spirit, walk in our midst tonight. Lord, we rejoice in this and praise thee. Thank you for this church. Thank you for these pastors. Lord, we're glad for these men that love God. Oh, we're thankful, Jesus. We see so few people that love thee today with all their hearts, Lord. A lot of people want to go to heaven. But, Lord, we're glad that we see here a people that want to glorify God, obey God, do what you want them to do. So we ask Jesus to send the awakening. Oh, God, send it. Send it, Jesus, we pray. Now, Jesus, take charge of this service. Anoint, guide, and direct in every way, we ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. I believe, choir, if you'll be seated, that John Sandy will sing for us this time. Amen. It's a helping us already.
I want to praise the Lord for His faithfulness. He touched my heart as we were singing, "Great is Thy faithfulness." On faithfulness, Jesus touched my heart, and I'm thankful for His faithfulness. Praise the Lord, Pastor, and thankful for the way He helped you this morning.
I'm so thankful
for the service this morning and for the message.
Amen, Daddy.
It was lifted.
Yes, sir.
It was tremendous.
Thank you, Jesus.
Pouring through you the eternal truths of God. And anointed preaching, I was trying to think whose anointing's upon him this morning. And finally came to the conclusion the anointing of the Holy Spirit was upon him.
Glory to God.
What a delight it is to sit under the sound of our son's preaching, anointed by the Holy Spirit. I'm just happy to be here. I don't know if anybody here don't love, so that's wonderful.
Oh, yeah. That's good, Daddy. Praise the Lord. We were just so delighted. I was to share from the 90th Psalm, inasmuch as most men of God and commentators of times past feel like it's the oldest Psalm, and traditionally has always been titled the Prayer of Moses, and of course the internal evidence found that it is so, much like some passages in the 33rd chapter of Deuteronomy. For us to be able to bring that to you this morning without note, or just to stand up and preach, it was a wonderful, wonderful privilege. And of course, its depth and its width and its height and its full flavor was, there's hardly any comparison to be made. A great preacher by the name of Isaac Taylor said that it was the deepest of theology, the best of imagery, and I forget some other things that he said about it. And to think that I'd be privileged to share this great psalm from the Prayer of Moses. And oh, I'm excited about it tonight. I'm excited about it. Some of the young people might not have felt the lift that some of the older people did and have carried the burden. Don't worry about that. Some of you may have. But as I looked out over the saints who've walked with me now these 11 years, I saw that they were feeding deeply. They were feeding from the things of God. And God brings different sermons and different ways of working in. But I saw that those who had suffered through the gospel message were being fed. And it helped my heart very much. And it was worth it all by God's wonderful grace. Brother Kraft is standing there, and you take the microphone to him.
Well, I want to thank the Lord and thank you both for that message this morning. That happened to be one of my favorite scriptures, the 90th Psalm.
What, David?
And you take a man that had the experience that the Moses did with God and with people. I don't know any other. Can't think of any other person in the Old Testament could pray a prayer like that.
That's the truth, David.
So I just thank the Lord for everything.
Oh, David, that's so good. Oh, dear Lord. May God preserve him. May God preserve our David. Oh, glory. Otis, I couldn't help but think of the battles that we fought together and individually in our own lives, some unknown to the other, but always in company of His Spirit and His anointing. And I thought, oh, Jesus, it's no wonder that Arlene noticed would be so moved. And you know, I hadn't even got a chance to look at David this morning, but we found out about it tonight, how he felt about it. And make such a comment. It'd take Moses to pray a prayer like that. And just with such joy. Oh, we had a time. 6 months ago, I could say that I didn't recommend much that I preach. And was seldom heard to ever say, listen to a tape, or ever even heard one of mine. But because of the depth of this, and the beauty of this great prayer, the joy of being able to expound upon it, I know that I can forthrightly say that it's a worthwhile sharing that's on that tape this morning. This thing will grow and grow and grow as you listen to it. And I'm pretty excited that the Holy Spirit would give me such freedom and give me such anointing that I didn't have to struggle for words. I didn't have to have note one to preach maybe one of the greatest things ever been written in all of God's Word. Oh, what a marvelous time we had. David, it was an appropriate response. I was about to say, may the Lord preserve you for so many years as is necessary for us to receive the help that we need in this place. Praise God forevermore. Grant it, Jesus, I pray. Praise the Lord. Yes, you saw a hand. Yes, was it Dorsis? Sister Browning, yes. Peggy, and then Doris.
I felt like I'd grieve the Holy Spirit if I didn't stand up.
And oh, I'm so thankful you stood.
Thank Him and praise Him for this morning. I've never had the Lord work with me quite like He did this morning.
Well, Peggy.
It was just up and down, the whole service from the time you stepped up and announced that Kathy was coming, and it just... I just got such a blessing out of it.
Yeah, just walking down the aisle with Kathy just in front of us, Brother, Sister Morgan, by God's grace, this sweet daughter here, daughter of the church and daughter of Thomas and Catherine, walked down in front of us this morning, Richardson. She walked down in front, and the Lord revealed last Tuesday she was to be one of our pastors. And we can't afford any more paid pastors. So, and Ronnie wanted her for pay. You see, because he doesn't have an associate, an assistant. But when we were in the meeting the other day, I was trying to find a way to give David's class to make a division so it might grow more. It's one of the successes of growth. You know, some people split because they're aggravated, but there's such a thing as dividing because of blessing. And so we thought, we're trying to find somebody to teach the singles. And the Lord had directed this way. I'd spoken to Steve about it before. And As I'd say, maybe Terry Hogue should teach that class. Or maybe Terry Richardson should teach it. We should take him from the junior high. No witness. Finally, Terry, when I said that, Terry spoke up and said, well, what about my sister? She was to graduate that weekend. That was last weekend. And when he said that, the Lord operated with Steve, then with me. I called Brother McAdams and said, John, would you confirm that God has spoken to us? He said, I would be happy to do so. So on Thursday, after we called Ronnie, I said, Ronnie, would it be all right if we invited Kathy to come home? And of course, he so graciously consented. And then we were able to call her at 10 o'clock the night before she graduated on Wednesday, and she received her directions. For so long as necessary, she'll be as the Apostle Paul and make tents. That is, you know, work for a living. But if God doubles the place or adds 100, who knows when we may be able to help her. But she knew Easter that she was coming home to be with us. And as she came down this aisle this morning, a number of folk were broken up. They could tell that God had blessed. This is our first woman pastor, Brother and Sister Morgan. And see, we're awfully glad to have her. She's young and beautiful, innocent and trusting, probably inside just trembling. But God's brought her to us. And we're pretty happy about it. God's working for grace. So Peggy's referring to that. And then on to the services. God worked so wonderfully and preciously this morning. Your uncle, by the way, saw what happened to me, how broken I was over the working of Jesus. And, of course, this happened to you this morning. Praise the Lord, Peggy.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I've had something on my heart that it's... for several months I wanted to get up and share, It's just a thankfulness to Jesus for letting me be here.
Praise the Lord.
And this morning, it'd been on my heart all morning. It just kept going through my mind about, since I was a baby, that the Lord must have had his hand upon me. And then when the dedication of the baby, I wept. I just couldn't keep from it. It was such a blessing to me.
Glory to God.
I just wanted to thank Jesus for bringing me here the way he did. Wow. Because it's a miracle that I'm here.
It's a miracle.
I don't know how many know, but I was adopted.
No.
And
not many.
I think of where I could be.
Yeah. See, you
if
brought
the
in.
Lord hadn't put me, Grayson.
Yeah, that's right.
And I'm
Take
so thankful.
It.
I could have been anywhere. I could have been in the gutter somewhere. I mean, I don't know where I would have been.
Yeah, where you'd be.
And I'm just thankful that I got where I was and that the Lord brought me here and put me with my family that I know and brought my husband to me.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
And yes. This morning it just kept going over and over, and I wanted to get up and say something, but I couldn't. And I just wanted to thank Jesus. I've been wanting to say that for a long time.
Praise the Lord. I'm so thankful, Peggy. Praise the Lord. Bring me my red book under there. I brought it tonight. Yes, this is the Episcopal prayer book that I read the ceremony out of, coming from the Anglican, ceremony. And I had such a wonderful time reading this service that I read to you this morning. I had some words on my heart, if I can find them here. When I read the charge to the godparents, lest you did not hear, remembering that for the child, the female child, there are two godmothers and one godfather. For the male child, there are two godfathers and one godmother. That makes sense, doesn't it? The influence of the male, doubly so upon the male child. The beautiful thing about it was that when I read this to Stephen this morning, God would just operate wonderfully. You see, it was C.S. Lewis, A.W. Tozer, and others who taught me to value these tried and proven prayers and services that came out of the old church. And some of them going back into the medieval church, some back to apostolic times. And so these words are so beautiful. It was A.W. Tozer that said, Brother Morgan, you may have remembered this, that a Protestant evangelical service that's without the Holy Spirit is very ugly. At least the services out of the liturgical churches are beautiful. And he said, if we're going to be without these great services of liturgy and of blessed anointing, as God has ordained many of these prayers through the great men of old, he said, for goodness sakes, let's be led by the Holy Spirit that it may be beautiful. The only thing that's more beautiful than these old services is a service like these anointed of the Holy Spirit, and a service in evangelical Protestantism that's anointed of the Holy Spirit. And so the Lord has helped us and blessed us. We had a most beautiful service this morning. This was addressed to the godparents. Dearly beloved, you have brought this child here to be dedicated. You have prayed that our Lord Jesus Christ would vouchsafe to receive her, to release her from sin, to sanctify her with the Holy Ghost, to give her the kingdom of heaven and everlasting life. Dost thou therefore, in the name of this child, renounce the devil and all his works, the vain pomp and glory of the world with all covetous desires of the same, and the sinful desires of the flesh, so that thou wilt not follow nor be led by them? And you heard them answer, I do. And then I said, having now in the name of this child made this promise, Wilt thou also on thy part take heed? There's where God dealt with me. Take heed that this child learn the Apostles' Creed, the Lord's Prayer, and the Ten Commandments, and all other things which a Christian ought to know and believe to his soul's health? And they answer, I will, by God's help. And yet for years we've run around with our shoulders, our chest stuck out and our shoulders back, and never sought once to teach our children the Apostles' Creed, the Lord's Prayer, that the Ten Commandments or the Beatitudes. And they grow up to be spiritual illiterates, thinking they have something better than what was, when they have something worse. Nothing to hold them in the time of testing. Put the Apostles' Creed in the soul of a child, and you put the gospel in a nutshell. Give them the Ten Commandments, and you give them the basis of all law in the Western Hemisphere. Give them the Beatitudes, and you give them a portrait of the Son of God, the heart of the Father Himself, and the picture of what the church should be, the man of God. Just these few things in the heart of a child will take him through the glory. God putting him there. What a great and wonderful thing it is. I'm thrilled. And so Peggy was thrilled this morning. These are great words. I read them to you again because you might not have gotten them. But I thought how wonderful it was. And you know, this precious mother was just as delighted. She didn't have any idea to the service till I got in this morning what I was going to do. But she was very happy. By God's wonderful grace. Didn't you like it when the minister stood with me and I said, the Lord be with you. And they answered, and with thy spirit. And I said, lift up your hearts. And they said, we lift them up unto the Lord. And I said, let us give thanks unto our Lord God. And the men with me said, it is meet and right so to do. Folks, if you got any glory at all, it's time to throw a hymn book or do something. It's so good. Oh, see, if the churches in Europe had had you folk to repeat words like this, there'd have been revival. In the old places, but all they had was somebody to read it. It perhaps was not called of God, and a people of God that had no vision at all in many places. And yet we have this great heritage. So it's my joy to bring this old-fashioned child dedication service into our services this morning. Doris?
I just want to say that I was thankful, too, for that service this morning. Kathy, that thrilled me so much. You know, Sister Powell, which was a former pastor, she married Bill Nye.
She did? Yeah. Doris, that's great.
And so it really thrilled me, you know, when you made the announcement that Kathy was going to be on the staff.
I saw your response.
Mm-hmm. And then your prayer at the close, it seemed to just put the icing on the cake. It really thrilled me. You know, so, you said that this morning that it was a strange service, and I couldn't keep from thinking that God's people are strange.
Yes, they are. Peculiar indeed. While you're talking, even this day, I have spoken to those in company with me about your husband. I said to Barbara, even coming up 35 tonight, I long to be with this man. This man who knew me and who loved me. And because of an honest heart and an open spirit, could put aside theological prejudices, theological preferences, whether to be wrong or right wasn't his concern. All he knew was that the man he had found as his pastor loved God, and he was going to get with him and wave the banner high. And he had a clearer vision of eternity than most men. How unique this man was. What's that doing?
I said he wanted to share you too.
Yeah, he wanted to share me. Yeah. Wanted his dear brothers in here. And of course his death brought him in. Yes. And to you that don't know the story, very quickly, it was hard for them, see, being very sincere, independent, conservative, Baptist preachers, men of God, very hard for them to understand how in the world I could hardly be a Christian because I wasn't premillennial. Well, Bill was premillennial too. But he knew that I belonged to God. And he's trying to get those fellows in here. Well, his death did it. And
Who can forget when I finally closed my Bible? Of course, Bill was very happy with my eschatology, doctrine of final things. But I told him, Bill, all I know is it's all going to pan out in the end. He said, that's right. He knew that was correct. But he knew my heart was right. When those men were brought in over here, sat on the front seat, and I finished the sermon, and finally, instead of closing, I began to expound a little bit on what Bill had told me. And when I did, those fellows got happy. Big men they are, like Bill used to be, before he died, before he lost his weight and all. And oh my goodness, they hollered, Amen, glory to God. They were wiping tears. What a blessed thing it was to see those three giant preachers come lay their hand on their brother's hand in the casket. Then to get up there with them. Then have them turn around. I believe it was Johnny that said to me, Preacher, you're about to burn me up. Man, I felt God in this place, he said. Boy, it was Carlos, I believe. I forget which one was on the couch. But when I walked in your home, he stood at attention. Now get this, folks. Theologically, he didn't know how I could even be included in grace. He just didn't know how. Taught certain things, you see. And when I walked in that day after that funeral, stood right to his feet at the couch. And he said, the only person I could feel more honored to have walk in is Jesus Christ himself. Why, I'm telling you, in my heart, I was saying, oh God, have mercy on me. My wife, who very seldom can go with me to places, usually these duties are by the pastors themselves. She said, I got to go. There's something, God's working in this family some way. The rest is over the hill somewhere of God's working in the Browning family. So I review that because it's such a wonderful thing that a man would love me so and see that where my heart was very important. And he'd want to get his brothers in here. He told him, says, I want to get you down there so you can see, learn how to love people. That's what he wanted to tell them some way. And they were men of love, men of grace. But Bill somehow saw something about us that few men see. God got the veil up some wonderful way. Praise his Lord. And we see we love him today. Doris, why would we go on and on about him after all these years?
See, I don't know. You know, to me, it doesn't seem like he's gone.
No, that's it. The same way with Betty's husband, Jack. Mm-hmm. See, I feel as close to Bill as I do to Jack. They're two men. Just think, man, what's it going to be like? They've already embraced each other. What's it going to be like to step just inside those gates and see those two men? It's going to be great. It's going to be wonderful. You're right. You see, you've encouraged my wife so much, you and Betty, that you've had such victory in death. That Bill and Jack went out with a shout. Jack flew into the arms of God. Bill, you were praying and reading scripture when he departed for glory. And your funeral services, as even was the Hale girls, when Dad Hale left us. And Mom, it was such glory. It tells us that Christianity is true, yes. That God's real, that God can give us victory in death. And we've seen so little of it in this life. But we preach that it ought to be so. You precious parishioners that don't have a name that comes out of Washington or a string of degrees a mile long or this, that, and the other, you've got more glory. What was it were you telling me tonight? What was it you were telling me?
Well,
the littlest saint.
I'm telling you that the most insignificant saint or the most uneducated and humble Christian knows more about God and life than the most educated scholar who doesn't know Jesus. You know about life and the meaning of life.
Martin Lloyd-Jones said that in his book, and he said the littlest saint that knows about God and his kingdom knows more about life than all these scholars. It means nothing. And you can see now the prayer of Moses. What does all this mean? In the eternity of God, in the finiteness of man having sinned against God, that God spoke us into existence, and he speaks the word of destruction. He said we're like a flood, we're like a dream. There's nothing to us like a tale that has been told. Our years may be 70 or even 80 by the grace of God. What does it mean? We're struck down even as he saw the Israelites go down. He said, with that, let us number our days and apply our hearts to wisdom. He said, oh God, having suffered all these things, send me some days of joy that we might rejoice as many days as we suffered. Let the beauty of the Lord be upon us and upon our children, and let the work of our hands be established. No wonder he prayed that way. I tell you, it's tremendous and it's great. Hallelujah.
You know, I used to fear death and be afraid of dead people.
Yes.
But I don't have that fear anymore.
No, it's all gone. Oh, death, where is thy sting? The sting of death is sin. Oh, has the Lord helped us tonight already? Praise the Lord.
I was real happy with your message this morning, Brother Oliver.
Why?
You know, I know that whenever you go, that God leads you. That you don't go unless God leads you.
I just can't do it. I have no heart to do it.
My son came in from Puerto Rico.
I flew. I saw him.
And I went up to see him was on Thursday. And when he got in, and he said, "Mother," he said, he came over to one of these airports in Los Angeles or wherever, and he said, "Out of this whole multitude of people," he said, "surely," it came to him, "surely there'll be someone here that I know." And he said, "Mother," I looked around, and guess who I saw? And he said, it was Brother Hogue. And you know that thrilled me, Brother Oliver, because I'm praying for my children to be saved.
I walked in and sat down right beside him.
And I
he
know.
Said, "I thought there'd be somebody I'd know."
That's right. And I was so thrilled that I couldn't help but just laughing out loud. Because I'm praying for those boys to be saved.
Yeah,
and I know that while you was talking to him, I believe with all my heart that he had you both there at the same time.
Yeah, that's right there.
I believe it with all my heart.
Sure did.
And I'm so
thankful. He was coming in from Puerto Rico.
Yes.
And the car badge sent him down, and he coming in. He's looking for somebody, for fellowship. And you see, I sat down and listened to him tell me about the experience of sailing. And oh, I had a time with him. While I was looking at him, I saw such character in his face.
Yes.
He has probably one of the finest faces on a man that's ever been put on a man. He really has quite a shape and beauty and character to his face. And he's very kind to me, always has been. And
well, he was so thrilled. He was really thrilled because he's looking for someone. And when he saw you, he said, "Mother," he said, "I was looking."
Yeah.
You know, he was looking for someone that he said, "He came to me, surely there'll be someone here I'll know." And it was Brother Hogue. And I'm so thankful that was
Jesus,
Brother Hogue. And
you.
I'm so thankful that God sent him that way.
Oh,
I'm
Jesus,
so thankful
thank
he went
you.
On the trip.
Oh, praise the Lord.
Because if he had not went on the trip, he wouldn't have met Dee Dee.
Boy, our paths crossed just at the right time. Today, when I walked out of this place, I knew that when I finally got out the door there, that my timing was timed to the second. When Ashley Ann said, "Praise the Lord," and then I turned and spoke to the dark, precious lady beside her, I said, "Oh, God had me timed perfect." I stopped just long enough to rejoice with my godson, Norman Oliver. Oh, I was having a time with him. Then I turned here and walked out. And I said to the boys in the study, I said, "Boys, my hesitancy here, my carefulness here, my where I was here and where I was there was timed exactly. What if I'd have been in a hurry? What if I'd have been discontented? What if I'd wanted to get home? What if I'd wanted to do this?" See, Jesus was helping me, and I knew that my steps were timed just as I came into D right there. And we were so glad to see, notice, and oh, it's just quite an experience.
Well, I'm looking for my boys to be saved because the Lord said if we'd be faithful and we would depend upon Him and believe upon Him,
amen,
that He'd bring them in.
Amen.
And
amen.
I believe that. I'm
I believe.
So thankful.
Praise the Lord. Behind you, Brother Gary, your wife.
Pastor Hogue, I don't really know why I felt the Lord working with me so strong, but I was thinking about Mary Jo and I were just talking before we came in here about how thankful we were to be here and how God brought us here and how so everyone here has such a different story and just how the Lord... It's so wonderful.
Did you say everyone here has such a good story?
Yeah, they have such
That's
a good story and such a different story.
It's different. It's
and
beautiful.
And everyone's background is so different
it
and
is
comes
wonderful.
From such different... And it's something that we've talked about, you know, everyone's talked about, and it's just, it might seem kind of old, I don't know, but I'm just thankful. And Mary Jo said, "Well, you know, I just wish that I could write a book about, you know, everyone could write their own, you know, story." And I said, "Well, it's already been done." You know, when everyone, you know, wrote to you.
You know, nothing's old. Your freshness, your beauty in our Lord, your being a wife and a mother now. See, I found you when you were a little girl, really.
Yeah.
Years and years and years and a decade ago I found you. And your hunger was great for God. You had a love for the saints. and see your background. See, I call you and Gary my Catholic kids. Yeah, just with pride. He's just so, I'm so thrilled. So I talk to Catholic people and tell them how God brought you in. I was telling about you this past week, Gary. And it, did you know, Gary, I got to talk a little about you, helping me in Sound of Music. And you knew how to, you need to how to sling the incense and bless people. And I was telling, boy, listen, Father Smith, I saw his 25th anniversary. I said, thank you for him, Jesus. He taught me, you know, how to genuflect and taught me how to kneel, how to give the wedding blessing. And I felt like a good Catholic and blessed on top of all of that, you know. We see, I was telling about this, and in the audience was a woman who runs a fine restaurant, and her husband is a Lebanese Catholic. He's from Lebanon, but he's a Catholic man. Oh, she said, it thrilled her so much. She was just so thrilled that she could ever find a Protestant minister that'd be like this. She's sitting out there in the audience. Her name was Nancy, and she was covered with glory. She was just filled with the love of Jesus. And so she wanted me desperately at that restaurant. Well, Bill and Donna took me the next day, and I got to meet this precious man. Oh, she stood there. She said, isn't this wonderful? She stood right there. You know what I did? I said, Nancy, this food is good. Oh, I had a steak, and I had some tabbouleh, and I had another little Lebanese thing. It was so wonderful. We just carried on. She looked at me, and she said, you know, it's good to hear that. Not many people do that. Not many people care what we cook up around here. I said, oh my, I don't know how you can put tabbouleh in your mouth and not be happy. I said, and this other thing I had, I forget what it is, but it was quite good also. And the steak was just cooked to perfection. I asked for medium, they brought me medium. And I just had such a great time. But you see, I got to talk about you kids. And here was a lady out there I didn't know about that loved Jesus. They had a Catholic husband, and she knew that if I love Catholics and appreciate having people with Catholic heritage in my church, that I could love her husband. So here he came, and boy, we had a time with him. See, now don't you know that she's told him a little bit about what I said up there? What if I were biased? I would have hurt somebody in Oklahoma, not knowing. Somebody that loved our Lord. Somebody's real glad. So see, you kids are valuable. And you, probably when we head up in the rapture, we'll probably be calling you our Catholic kids by God's grace. See, it's a great privilege. David's our Baptist preacher. Well, that came in handy because Bill's got a Baptist preacher with him. Man by the name of Jim Watkins that may be here this weekend. Oh, yeah. I said, yeah, I got one of those too. Yeah. He's got a pedigree that'd make men shake in their boots. The education that boy's got and the degree he's got. See, it just helped us real wonderful. And God did a miracle with this Baptist preacher. I mean, it is a miracle. We may have time to share more about that later, but how thankful we are. See, I'm just as happy with you now, more so than when we were sitting around the table and Jesus was working so wonderfully at youth camp. I'm just as happy now. There's nothing old about it. It's beautiful.
It just seems like fresh. You can't review enough. You know, I can't. I've tried not to say too much because I probably feel like I'm, you know, boring people. But what God did for me and, you know, how He knew about my searching heart.
He knew.
He knows even when you think... Even He knows more than you think you know.
Oh, yeah.
You may not even realize that you know. But like the Lord led me there, and I didn't know maybe that I was what I needed. But what I needed was God, and He just is wonderful. And I just wanted to praise the Lord for what all He's done for me. And then I want to praise the Lord for bringing everyone else here, because everyone here ministers to me.
And
I love everybody very much, especially my pastor. Praise the
Lord. I was just saying, the thing I saw in your face was a love for me that's seldom found. A love for me that's seldom found on the face of the earth, just as a little girl. And Jesus said, "You're the lights of the world." And I didn't want to go to that youth camp. Stephen can remember this quite well. And Brother Helm called one night. I said, Brother Helm, I don't know whether I'm physically able to stand it. He said, son, God will help you. He tells me He wants you there. And while I was there, I found you. And that has resulted in several things. The timing was right. God will help you in that place. Isn't that wonderful? See, when I was speaking of the light of the world, Jesus, through His blood, helped me to be a light. So you found someone that could reflect the light of Jesus, because this was your heart. This is what you were looking for. Praise His holy name. Gary? Hallelujah. Behind you, Sister Cox.
What we've been doing last, I don't know how long it's been, makes no difference because time doesn't mean anything here anyway. I was reading in one of Watchman Nee's books this week of how important this sharing is. There's not very many congregations where this privilege is granted to people. And as Pam, yeah. As Pam said just a minute ago, it uplifts us to hear the experience of each person, because each person has a different experience.
Yes.
And it's important that we share our joys, we share our sorrows, that we allow everyone as well. God knows what's happening to all of us.
Exactly.
But I don't know. You don't know. But it is important. These periods are important. And Steve made me have something else to say. My heart's just been pounding out ever since we started this sharing period.
Amen.
I was talking to a precious person this morning about Christian school. And she said to me, well, there's just one thing about the Christian school, that they are so protected that they don't know anything about reality, what's really happening. I said, well, now, here's the way I feel about it. If you raise a child up in the right environment and they have the right teaching, they're going to be associating with the world some period during the day. But if they have the period while they're in school where they have the correct kind of teaching, as they go through the elementary school and on into high school, then they're going to have a foundation where the devil's not going to be able to shake. And I don't feel that the Christian school is a place of too much protection.
Yeah.
I think it's important.
Yeah.
It's important.
You know, Sister Cox, I'm reminded that Dr. Schaefer said that reality is a composite of that which is seen and unseen.
That's right.
And without that which is unseen, there is no reality, because that which is unseen lasts forever. That which is seen is rapidly passing away. And so in Christian school, we simply attempt to give them reality rather than shortchange them and offer them hell and try to call it reality. You see, something that has no everlasting value. It shocks me that
people... And they get that foundation there that they're not going to get anywhere else.
Let me tell you, that's right. Amen. With the television screen and with the interaction that we have, we touch shoulders enough with the world today.
That's right.
We need our kids under Christian influence far more than we have. Think of the hours they spend in public schools. Think of the hours on end. Very little in the home, very little in the church. Very few churches have services like we do, where it runs into 7 to 10 hours a week. But for most part, the kid has 1 hour of unanointed services.
That's right.
And then 70 to 80 hours of hellish whatever.
That's right.
Who wants that? It seems to me that by God's grace, we're offering them a better balance and a better chance to interact with their society than has ever been offered before. Now, I know this has not been always true with result to public school, and it's not a put down. It's only an acknowledgement of the fact that permissivism, I'm so disturbed at the people in HEW and in the IRS and in various departments who in their behaviorist ideas and atheistic and humanistic thoughts have ruined our public schools, who have made sex education amoral, if they're going to have it, amoral, not moral, who tried the article in a paper yesterday about that woman in the textbooks.
Yes.
And Alice Moore was objecting again. She said, we don't try to teach these things with value. We try to teach them neutrally. Well, you're offering a kid nothing but hell when you do that.
That's right.
No value. That's what education's about.
That's right.
Christian school offers value, goal-oriented, a God-oriented view of the universe, and gives that kid something that can help him, because the pull of the carnal nature is downward. We got to have something to work against that pull and get away from the gravitation to pull downward that has happened to us since the Garden of Eden, since we fell.
That's right. I didn't get in until about 12 o'clock this morning for the service. But from the few minutes that I was here, I'm sure it must have been one of outstanding anointment this morning.
Oh, Jesus.
Because
so nice.
I just sat back here with tears in my eyes all the time. It don't take but 5 minutes just to step in that door. And I get blessed and blessed and blessed and blessed. And I think this morning, I don't know, I seemed like you just couldn't go home and get your rest like you should. You just kept working and working and working.
Yes, yes, yes.
But I thank God for your obedience.
Thank you, Jesus.
I thank God that we do have the privilege.
Praise the Lord.
Of being associated with men of God.
So thankful for the privilege.
Who are not fearful of anyone, but they do just exactly what God tells them to do to the best of their ability.
Lord, help us, we pray.
And I want to praise God for you.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. And for the opportunity that our precious young people have.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'm sure that they are not aware of what a privilege it is. I imagine I'm just about one of the older members of the congregation. And I know I never did have the opportunity that these youngsters have.
No.
And I thank the Lord that they are faithful.
Thank you, Jesus.
That they love their Lord.
Oh,
they love their pastors.
Yes.
They love their elders. And they are faithful. And boys and girls, God loves you,
yeah.
And He has a great work for you to do.
Amen.
You are the light of the world.
Amen.
We Christians are the light of the world.
Yes.
The only light that Jesus has.
Right.
And if we do not do His bidding, the light is going to be darker than what it is now. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I don't say much in front of people.
I'm aware of that.
And this lady right over here, told her that she was adopted.
Yes,
and I wasn't legally adopted, but my heart started pounding. And
yes, sir.
It's a long story, if I may say, but I'll bring it down into a couple minutes. And then Pam said that everybody has an individual story, and boy, it hit me again, and I just can't sit down any longer.
Wonderful. Glory to God.
About 4 or 5 years ago, I became a Christian, and
yes,
as probably most new Christians, we don't know anything. I still don't know anything.
Sure.
But I went to a beautiful Church of God in Michigan, and it was a strict German church. You know, if someone said amen, everybody would look at
them, yes,
you know, and
I
you
understand.
Just sat in your pews and didn't say nothing. When it was over, you went home.
Sure.
I came down here to visit on vacation, see my mom, father-in-law, and everybody, and you're preaching, and Pastor Steve, at this time, of course, I didn't know any of you. It's, I get to witness to that. Well, I didn't even know what the witness was, you know, and I'd lean over my wife, you know, what are they talking about? I can't believe this, you know, but praise the Lord. You know, he's been with me, and I know that it's true, you know, and I'm getting closer to him,
thank
and it's
you,
so
Jesus.
Fantastic,
oh,
you know.
Praise the Lord.
We'd go back and sit and say, Lord, if you want me down Scott Depot, sell my house quick.
Oh, yeah.
First person from our church that looked at it bought it. So, you know I'm supposed to be here. You know, and praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus, and everything else for this. The second part of my story,
yes,
is when I was 2.5 years old, my real parents didn't want me for some reason. I don't know if the economics or what. The Wilsons, who took care of me, were about 50 years older than I was. So legally, they could not adopt me. And I was given permanent custody to the state. And they took off with me, and they ran different towns in Michigan and Illinois and stuff like this to keep me.
Yeah.
So there's an awful lot of love there.
I loved you, yes.
When I was about 17, my aunt, on the people who brought me up, slipped and said that I was adopted. I never knew anything about it. And so I went to my mother and father, Wilson, and asked them, and they sat down and told me, yes, you know, that they took care of me, that they were not my real parents. And they said I had a brother, and that's about all she could remember. You know, last time I saw him, I was 2.5 years old. Now, in this case, it's been 28 years now.
Right.
And I started looking for him when I was about 17, went to Grand Rapids, where I was born and everything, found my mother and father's marriage license, my birth certificate, and couldn't find his.
Yeah.
But I didn't know how old he was, except for he was a couple years older than I was. And so I kept looking, and then when I moved back down to Benton Harbor, I got a lawyer friend. He started looking and so forth, and he found some papers. I found out that I had a brother, and I found out his name, and I found out his birth date.
Yes, sir.
So I started over again, you know.
Right.
And, well, I never found him, But then coming back down here, I met a man who had my last great hope to find him. I can't get into the details because he could get in trouble, but he searched the United States wide.
Yes, sir.
Something, and he could not find him. So then, I think it was the next night, night after there or something, Karen and I sat down and started talking that my lawyer friend who had done all this work for me, this was over 2 years ago now, had some extra papers that he did not send us. And so I called him up at home and said, would you send these papers, you know, down to us? Well, I got the mail when I come home last Monday, and we looked in, and it had the newspaper clipping of my mother's death, my real mother. She was killed in 59. Had my grandmother's name and my mother's sister's name, which I didn't know I had at that time. And so we called information up in Michigan, and I asked for a name, and they said, yes, we have one. And so I called, and it was an old lady. I said, oh boy, here it is. And
sure.
Started talking to her. Well, it wasn't the right lady. So I hung up and said, well, there it goes. You know, I don't have a chance to find him again. And Karen says, wait a minute, let me try it. So she called back, and it sounded like the same operator. And she asked for the same name again. The operator gave her the number. It was the same number I had. So that wasn't it. Then all of a sudden, the operator said, wait a minute. And I don't know if, we don't know if she went to another book or what. I don't know how, you know, long distance operators work, but she says, I have this person's name about 50, 60 miles from Grand Rapids. And we took it and I called, and it was another elderly lady. And I started talking to her and I gave her my name, my mother's name, so forth. She said, yes. And so it was my grandmother. First time I had talked to her in 28 years. You know, and if the Lord wasn't there dealing with the same operator for us to call back, you know, I'd probably never found him.
Say that been it.
Never
probably
known.
Been it.
So we asked her about, I asked her about my brother, and she says, yes, he's living in Grand Rapids where he was born and so forth. So I got the number and called him up and started talking to him. First time I've talked to him in 28 years, first time you know, that I knew he was alive. And so we're going up there Father's Day weekend to see him. He's getting my grandmother, who's 83 years old, and my cousins and everything. So I found my half of my family. 30 years it's taken me. Praise the Lord for being
Lord.
Down here.
Thank you, Jesus. Oh, glory to God. Keith, yes. Praise the Lord. Oh, the joy.
I just want to praise the Lord for His love and His mercy. Amen. And His grace, and for Amen. The way He's helped here tonight and the way yeah. He helped this morning.
Oh,
He was feeding my soul. It was good.
Glory to God.
Thank for the way He helped you. I didn't want you to stop.
Yeah.
It was great.
Praise the Lord. I'm thankful, Keith. I saw your face and saw that God had helped you to hear me, and I was very grateful, probably because of the gift that's in you by God's grace. Oh, bless His holy name. Yes. Mary Jo, when Pam spoke of Mary Jo, this is the lady she spoke about. Amen.
I'm so excited about something. I just had to share it right now.
Well, sure.
I've been wanting to share with you for this particular thing for a long time, but I want to share about four little things, if I could take that much time.
Certainly.
Thank you for the sermon this morning, because I told you before, Moses was one of my most favorite Bible characters.
That's right. You did say that.
And that sermon was precious. But equally as precious this morning, for a long time I've been wanting to hear the youth choir saying, He watches over Israel, because that's very special to me.
Yes.
Oh, and I'm thankful for that too.
Oh, yes.
And I was also very thankful for Jeannie's prayer when she prayed when the baby was.
Yes.
That was extremely beautiful.
Extremely beautiful.
I can't praise Him enough for such wonderful attitude of love that she had when she prayed for that.
Yes.
And it was simply beautiful.
Yeah, we noticed that.
And I want to praise God for that.
Praise the Lord.
And I had an unusual experience. Well, no, I can't say it's unusual, because I claim these kind of experiences all the time, but Pastor Steve, I think he knows what I'm going to tell. Last Wednesday, Ruth sold me a copy of A Voice in the Wilderness.
Yes.
And I have it on my heart to buy approximately 5 of them for people that I know.
Yes.
So I can send it to them and hope that like a magnet, that it will work in their hearts too and possibly draw them closer to the Lord.
Amen.
And I had $5 that I guess if I could have said, well, I could have used it for groceries or whatever, but I felt the need to do this for the Lord. And, you know, I've said so many times, He works in such mysterious ways, His wonders to perform.
That's right.
Within about 12 hours later, God paid me back not only $5, but 10.
Amen.
That's sure. A double portion.
Amen.
Now, that was wonderful, and I got so excited. I called Pastor Steve, and he was also. I made him tell me which one of the pastors was there, and I could share that with him. I got a hold of him, and I was so excited about that. But this is what's been on my heart for a long time that I've got to share with you tonight.
Right.
The second time I came, I believe, last fall, about 10 or 15 young men stood up there and sang the song Stout-Hearted Men, and it blessed me.
Yeah.
And in reading Lauren Helm's book, A Voice in the Wilderness, this past week I read one of the chapters, and it was talking about people in the churches, as a church as a whole, I assume he means, that they don't have malice and bitterness and contrite, contrary hearts and things like that, and that they criticize. And when these young men sang, the stout-hearted men, it goes like, you know, give me 10 men and give me 100 and make it 1,000 and make it 10,000. And when Pastor Steve asked me about a week ago to be on prayer chain, my heart's been heavy for America for 20 years or more.
Yes, ma'am.
And this is something that I started praying for.
Yes, ma'am.
And I hope I live to see it happen.
Yeah.
That I would like to see here in this church 10 dedicated men for the proposition to be the ones that would go out and get 10 each until there was 100. And when each person here that had the 100 made the 100, that they would make 1,000 until this church is 10,000 strong. And I believe it could be done here because this church is out of all the churches that I've ever seen, Pastor
Jesus. Hope,
this church has less of any of these things than any church I've ever seen in my life.
God, help me.
And that's my prayer for this church, that it will become 10,000 strong. And I don't know, I just pray that this church can be the thing that Jesus needs to wake America up. I think it can be done in this
Father,
church.
Help us, we pray.
And that's my prayer
praise
and
the,
desire.
Praise the Lord. Thank you for that vision, Mary Jo, and your faithfulness. Oh God, help us to hear what she says. Last week, my son heard one of the children at school say, the preacher over there at the Scottsdale Christ Fellowship says that next week that they're going to have 10,000 in church, and after that, Jesus is going to come. Well, it's pretty good if it were true. I never said that. But years ago, the Holy Spirit witnessed that if we were to become one as a body of Christ, that our responsibility is 10,000 souls. 10,000 souls would be drawn out of the several thousand, 250,000 or 300,000 that are in Huntington, Charleston area. And so, but you know, the devil just hates so bad. He just hates so awful that, see, somebody resented that when it was shared. Then they went out and shared it somewhere else. And by the time it got to a young person, he thought that I'd made a cultic prophecy and that I'd predicted the end of time and that, you know, going to have 10,000 people. Well, if anybody knows their Bible, any church that will become one can have 3,000 souls in one day. It's no big thing, you know, no big prophecy. That if God can find a people He can trust and find a persons who really become one, He can turn it into 3,000 in one day's time. That's the Holy Scripture. So all it was said was many years ago was that if we could become one in with Christ, go down in humility, and all of this stuff be removed from us, the Lord could trust us with 10,000 souls. And I believe it because the Holy Spirit witnessed it. And the record is in Pentecost. By 14 years, Jerry Falwell tells us, according to the best research, half of Jerusalem was saved in 14 years. Half of Jerusalem was converted in 14 years. But it began on the day of Pentecost with 3,000 souls. So, Mary Jo, we're thankful for that vision, and we're listening carefully by God's grace. All right? John, where did you go? Yes. And where's John at? Okay, John, if you'll get ready to sing, praise the Lord. Yes, Dad?
I just want to say that I'm thankful to be here tonight. In fact, I'm thankful to be here this morning.
Amen.
Because I got out of bed this morning and I didn't get out. I crawled out. And I went in and held myself on the sink and sheathed. And I went back and got my clothes on. And I said, if the Lord's help, if he can get my, you know, get if I can get just... Get them on. I'm going down to Scott Depot where I can be down there and see the saints of the church and see the Holy Spirit working in the pastor and so forth. And I made it.
Amen.
I laid down this evening on the couch, and I'm back here tonight. And I just want you all to know that I do appreciate each and every one of you.
God bless you, Dad.
Even though it is hard on me. Thank you.
Boy, he's a beautiful help to us. Praise the Lord. Yes. Amen. Amen.
All I want to say is, praise the Lord, my soul, and all is within me. Praise his holy name. I felt that since last night, and I'm so thankful for the lift Jesus gave me through prayer meeting, the way he's helped me today, because the past few weeks have been pretty hard. But I'm thankful to know that he never lets us down. We may let him down, but he's always there to help us and pick us up. And I'm thankful. Praise the Lord.
Oh, hallelujah. Jesus. Praise the Lord. When this service began, I stepped out in cold, naked faith, just to try to obey God. And the Lord has helped us. Amen. Praise his holy name. Yes, sir, certainly.
I wouldn't share this unless the Lord showed me this morning. I came to church with the Reesers, and they've been quite a help to me since I started school in January again. And as I was sharing with them, I knew at that time that during the day, sometime I would probably share. Never really felt that way before. I was supposed to sing a song to other services, but it never worked out, and that was fine with me.
Sure.
So he says, we'll just trust about it. And so as I was sharing with him, I knew that I know it's for a person in particular, but I didn't know if it'd be in Sunday school class with Dave or what, but I wanted to share that if I could.
Yes, sir.
Since I've been out of school in Indiana for about 2 years and 3 months, I've had to learn a lot of things the hard way. I've done a lot of bucking. I've rebelling in my own self and criticism. And just in January, Christ showed me that I was supposed to go back to school. And I know that this may not seem like much to some people, because like Jill Keister has been a big help to me. She's a 4-point student. And some of those students here, Jack and them, are doing very well. But as the Lord having to go back to school, I keep referring to a situation I had back in during the time I met you, I think, at youth camp.
Yes.
The Lord showed me that if I was willing to let go of anything that I wanted, whether it was upright or not, and do the best I can, not self-works, but do the best I can, then he could take me through anything.
Yeah.
Now, that's a big thing know that. I was just a very young teenager at that time.
Yeah.
And so I did. I got the point. It's a long story. I won't even go into it. But I said, okay, Lord, I give up. I said, if you don't want me to have this, I won't do anything. But I was in a situation where I needed help if I couldn't do it myself. I said, well, here I am. Okay, I've given it to you. And within minutes, God took me through the situation, just in minutes.
Yes, sir.
And I knew then that God was going to help. And then later on in life, I had an eye operation. And I was told I was restricted from everything, bowling, everything, the rest of my life. I was supposed to stay away from people a lot. And a young teenager, that's very hard anyway at that age. And I had a situation that the Lord showed me that he was going to take care of me. And on and on. And then since I went back to school, the Lord showed me that if you're doing the best you can, and you know that it's not in your strength, then don't limit anything God will do.
That's right.
Don't put any limits on it.
No, sir.
If you believe that you can't do it,
that's right,
then why limit it at all?
Yeah.
So I put down a piece of paper. I knew I was supposed to go back to school. I knew that the Lord had showed me that if you do the best you can, yeah, then I'll take care of the rest. Then I claimed a 4-point this semester. Never in my life. And the battles that came from that were tremendous. On the bus up, coming back with people and situations, on a test situation that should have never went the way it did. I'd come home after church Sunday night and study straight through for a test. I had a very hard on my eyes, just very, very taxing.
Yes.
And I got a grade yesterday and I had enough 4-point.
What job?
And this is such a miracle. Because when I was in high school, they suggested I go to school for the blind.
Yeah.
And I went, and my pride kept me going before, yeah, I knew that to give it to God.
Oh.
And then I've had to go through that transition of letting go of that pride.
That's right.
I've had to work at that.
And
I'm so thankful the Lord's helping me in little ways.
Praise God.
To accept the times.
That's good.
It's been the biggest battle I've had, and young people, the biggest battle we have is accepting, believing God has dreams for us, but at the same time, yeah, not clinging to them.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Hardest thing to do, to want something and believe in it and, yeah, not look, yeah, for it in the wrong way. It's just,
right,
and I'm thankful the Lord's helped me in that area.
Man.
And if this isn't very exciting to you,
yeah,
then it's a good sign why you don't think God's doing much for you.
Yeah.
Because if you really believe that you can't do anything yourself, and if you'll stop comparing yourself to other people. See, I love music. Music's in my heart so much.
Yes, sir.
I've had to let go of it all. And I've never had any confidence. I just loved it.
Yes, sir.
And I look at people like Guy or someone, Sally is very gifted. That's hard on me.
For sure.
But if I'll look at what God's doing for me personally and not compare it, then it's a miracle.
That's good.
But I can go to school and say, well, Jill got a 4-point, and she probably didn't even study half as hard as I did, and this and that. And I could just, you know, shove it off as nothing. But if we'll just look at the situation from our own life,
well, good,
and see where God's brought us,
amen.
See, Satan will put us beside someone else.
Yes, sir.
And say, well, they've done that too.
Yes.
But you haven't come from where they came from.
That's right, John.
And for God to create, do that miracle, and for Dave Reese and his wife to pray for me like they did,
oh, it's
and different people.
Yes, sir.
The story's going. I've got to share with, through my grades, I've been able to share my testimony with all my teachers. I taught a class at State one day on airbrush. I gave my testimony.
Watch out.
And so many things have come out of it.
Amen.
Just tremendous things. And I believe this song really fits the sharing in this here. And I want to share that.
I believe it, John.
Life goes by, so much is past. Most things change, but some things last. So many days just slip away, mellowing there like yesterday. My mind forgets a million things, places, dates, and names of kings. Only one memory stays new, the day I gave my life to you. The things I've done, the things I've seen, melt into a lifelong dream, and I become what I've gone through. I am so glad I've been there with you. My mind forgets a million things, places, dates, and names of kings. Only one memory stays new, the day I gave my life to you. The day will come when I'm so old, one more day will be like gold, and all the days I ever knew my life with you. My mind forgets a million things, places, dates, and names of kings. Only one memory stays new, the day I gave my life to you. Only one memory stays new, the day I gave my life to you.
John, if for no other reason, you had to have me home for you to sing that. He said, the song was on your heart, but it got blocked, and it got blocked. But if just for me, it was worth...
One of the most beautiful bass solos
I've heard. Oh, I thought, Jesus, I said, that song's made for John. Oh,
I looked. I didn't even catch it, and the word said about being old, growing old.
Yeah.
Not fit this morning. And I told Steve, there's only one other time that I ever mentioned that I had a song. And I've had to sing for months, but I didn't know, but I wouldn't say a thing until I thought I could mention it to him. And it was, I got fought and fought, and so that's why I didn't press it.
You did the right thing. See, it held it for me, and so I could be here with you tonight to hear this beautiful voice and this beautiful heart that comes through that voice. And by the way, John Bruffy got these. See what if you hear yourself better, choir? Yeah. You can hear better, can't you? Yeah. See these monitors? That's why we can hear better. Now, when you're up here, you can hear better because we were in a sound vacuum back here, and now these boxes are helping us, and we can just hear him clear. Why, it sounded as good as anything Hollywood could ever fix up, as far as I'm concerned. But oh, they can't fix up a man like this. No siree. And I kept saying to Steve, look at him. Look how nice he looks. Look what a man he is, by God's grace. And even when he'd drop his head, the Holy Ghost would witness. Just put his hand down, God would witness. See, isn't this wonderful? Oh, he's fought some battles, folks. But oh, God's given him the song.
Yes, sir.
So we want to hear that again. God will bring that back to us. Oh, right on time.
I believe the Lord tells me something right quick.
Yeah, what? All right.
I'm going to tell John.
Yeah, wonderful.
Brother Hamm was here in a meeting. We were at a restaurant, and I think you and I were there together with Brother Hamm.
Yes.
And you were telling him how the Lord had helped me with the choir.
Yes, sir.
To just sort of give up my desires for some of the classical numbers.
Those first few years, several years.
Right.
You just had to die. Right. First year, you didn't even feel the anointing. I did, but you didn't.
No, seldom ever.
Seldom ever. Otis did. Peggy did. Choir did, but he didn't feel it. See, his prejudices were so high, his training was in such a gear that it took him a year or so to die out where he could tell that the glory was falling. I'd say, you know, you hear that in Peggy's fingers? He couldn't hear anything in her fingers. He couldn't hear the anointing. But he did. After he died to a certain degree, see, then he began to hear what we were hearing.
Yeah. Well, what I wanted to say was that we were, you know, we were trying to give thanks to God for helping us to, you know, die out to how we'd felt. And Brother Hamm looked up at us.
Yeah.
And gave us something back.
It is.
You see, and this is what we've got to keep in mind, because we thank God for our high points. We thank God for the wonderful times when
that touches my heart.
We've been lifted and we've pressed our way through something. And
yes, sir.
Maybe we were in it for a long time, and oh, praise God! All of a sudden, the light breaks through,
yes, sir.
God lifts us. But what we forget sometimes. Now, he deals with me now.
Yes, sir.
If there's another one waiting for you later.
Oh, yeah.
And then there's another one waiting for you later. Right. You're going to be facing something else later.
Yes, sir.
And it's proper. Yeah. It's proper, and it glorifies God for us to say, thank you, Jesus, for what you've done for John, because John's been through a dry spell for quite some time. But what I want to say to him is, John, this won't be the last.
No, sir.
This won't be your last struggle.
No, sir.
Now, God's been faithful to you up to this point, and he'll be faithful to you on out there.
And the high points come again and again.
Brother Ham looked at me that day, and I said, you know, you said to him, Brother Ham, God's helped Stephen to die out. He says, well, he'll have to continue to do that. See, that's just not it. That's not it, man. God helped me down to that point. But he was saying, Stephen, what he was saying to me, very lovely, is, Stephen, your battle's not over. Your dying out's only begun.
Yes, sir.
See, I hadn't even got started.
Beautiful.
I thought in those days that, you know, praise the Lord, I've really gained some ground. Oh, my brother, that's just what you think. A.W. Tozer said, Brother Morgan, he says, God looks down here at us, and after we've struggled, and after we've worked, and after we've prayed, he said, God looks down from heaven and says, son, come on up higher.
Amen.
Come on up higher,
Amen.
Brother. We got to keep climbing. We can't reach a plateau and just stay there. There's a call upward. And it really hit me forcibly sitting there in that seat.
Ooh,
John, be encouraged.
Yes, sir.
God's given you the victory.
Yes, sir.
He's lifted you.
And
he's given you some insight.
Yeah.
But, brother, just hang right in there, because on out here in a few months or whatever, you're going to be looking at something else.
All right.
God will help you with it.
No wonder then the Coventry Patton Moore said, of all the seasons, love most winter.
Winter.
Mm-hmm. Of all the seasons, love most winter.
Yes.
And the same thing is said in an old song that says, I cherish the old rugged cross.
Yes.
And I've known for years that song was sung with very little, if any, appreciation for what was involved. But when we get to that place, then we can be blessed in the hidden time, the dying out time. This was so good, Steve, because you're still dying today. When I walked in that door, if people knew the weight of my heart because of certain things, same old death, same old struggle, by God's grace, and yet beautiful victory, just the joy of your life is worth the whole thing, being here tonight.
Yes.
That God, through all this sharing, and then John would sing right there.
Yeah.
So beautiful. Yeah,
Jesus answering prayer.
He's answering prayer.
And working with...
And the reason Steve would share this way is because Stephen's trying to help not just John, but and he
You're
can
right.
encourage himself and me, but to help all of you.
You're right.
That this goes on.
We
know people have had high points, but they aren't here tonight.
Uh-uh.
They've gotten up as if the victory had come forever. They aren't here.
Yes, sir. That's what happens.
They didn't continue with their cross.
No, you got to.
And God has witnessed that whenever we leave services, we lose the victory.
We're losing it.
Whatever battle we're in, God says, stay in the service. But he that goes out and stays out and removes himself is on his way to losing the victory.
You're right.
He talked to you and Rodney about that.
Oh, yes, sir.
He told me.
Yes.
They were praying over someone days ago.
Yes, sir.
Praise the Lord.
I just want to say that.
Yes, sir.
I just really feel deep with it that this was for a particular reason. I share this. After everybody was sharing,
it was
like I felt like, oh, you better be quiet and just sing.
No, you're supposed
to
share.
But it was on my heart so much, and God doesn't deal with me like that much at all. But there's someone, at least one person, that wanted need to hear what I had to say, and I hope I didn't miss it.
John, you were great.
And even God brought someone. I feel like God even brought a person, a particular person, to me since a day or so ago, before I even knew I was going to share.
See? Amen.
And I wanted to let you know that what I'm sharing is not out of a high.
No.
I'm not in a high.
Well, he knew that.
Steve
knew that.
And this song, I don't know if you know it or not, but singers may know this. Getting a chance to sing a song was for me, if nothing else, because it's healing for me to sing. And it's been months and months and months, and I'm thankful. I'm thankful that God, see, it's important. When I first came here, I loved to sing so much. And the first prayer I had was, oh, God, and see, I didn't think he'd pick me my word, but he did. I said, God, it says, if I'm not supposed to sing to help me to die, then you just do that. And every time we'd come, I would just say, just thank you, Jesus. And I would just say, thank you, Lord. And I'd fight that. Steve knows the battles I've had. And I'd fight and I'd talk to you about it. But still, it's a thing you hit, like Dave said once, it's something you have to experience. It's, you don't die without struggling.
That's right.
And you don't get on the cross and just rest on it. And so it encouraged me because I get the impression from the service of some people that they're having a great time on the cross. And I'm just, you know, so I'm just...
I just want you to know that this was great.
Said he endured the cross for the joy that was set before him. Brother, the cross wasn't funny. It hurt.
Yes.
Sir, shameful.
I just can't get over the miracle that when they was praying for me, God's promised my healing.
Oh, yes, sir.
But
oh,
see, yeah. The beautiful thing about it is I'm not looking for it.
No.
No, well, I'm not looking for it at all. People get a hold of that. See, that's wonderful because when they was anointing me, because of school did so much to my eye. It was so hard. I still got a semester and a summer to go.
Certainly.
I said, Dave, I'm so thankful because God's already given me a great amount of victory in rest, and that's the greatest he could do. The healing's not the greatest.
No.
The greatest is what he's already done.
Oh.
And like I shared before here, what God's done for me is for the church.
Yeah, right.
And what God's going to do is for the world.
Right, right.
And if the church is looking for something else, then they're going to be disappointed.
That's right.
And so I'm just so thankful that
would you sing it again? I'm afraid. I don't know how long it'll be. It might be the next service. But would you sing it again? It's so beautiful.
Right now?
Yes, because there's folks in this audience that God speaks to while you're singing. Praise the Lord. Amen. Oh, yes. Amen. She wanted to praise Jesus and thank him for bringing her from where she was, which was a long, long, long way off. Praise God for her thanksgiving. And what she does when she does that is she gains a little victory. She gains some strength, and it helps us all. Praise the Lord.
You know, it's even appropriate that Brother Morgan be here because it was at his church that the Lord gave me the book that I've been working on.
Oh, John.
And he was the first to hear it. And so that was so wonderful, and Jesus is really working in that. And that's, if nothing else, then the sharing of what God's helped me to get into during my waiting is for the encouragement of those to hang on that there is something there.
It's true.
And usually something you can't do.
Right. Right. Praise the Lord.
Life goes by, so much is past. Most things change, but some things last. So many days just slip away, mellowing there like yesterday. My mind forgets a million things, places, dates, and names of kings. Only one memory stays new, the day I gave my life to you. The things I've done, the things I've seen, melt into a lifelong dream, and I become what I've gone through. I am so glad I've been there with you. My mind forgets a million things, places, dates, and names of kings. Only one memory stays new, the day I gave my life to you. The day will come when I'm so old, one more day will be like gold, and all the days I ever knew are measured by my life with you. My mind forgets a million things, places, dates, and names of kings. Only one memory stays new, the day I gave my life to you. Only one The day I gave my life to you.
What we marvel is, it's better the second time than the first.
Thank you, John.
John, did you hear me? I said, I had to be home when you sung that song. Yes. This is a great day. Yes. Praise the Lord.
Oh, it's so beautiful.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Okay.
Blessed. Blessed. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah.
Yeah, she's back there.
Yeah, glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. What a service. Glory to God.
You know, that's something you would have thought that when I was 16 years old,
yeah,
that song touched my life.
Boy,
so much,
did it ever.
Someday be such a blessing to us.
It really is.
Dad,
yeah.
And Mama had, because she likes to praise
oh,
God.
Oh, it's good. It's good.
Okay, quick.
Thank you, Jesus.
The gates open wide at the close.
One of the reasons an alcoholic is so happy when you hear him testify in an AA meeting, because he finally reached the bottom and got so low, and he realized his condition and realized he needed help, and he found some people and found a higher power that he could depend upon to get him out of all that miry clay. And when he gets up and testifies in front of the AA boys and the men and women, he's happy because God done something for him. Brother, how much more should the saints of God be happy in a place and willing to shout the praises of God when God has reached down and gotten them out of the old miry clay and put them on a high place and caused them to rejoice because they know wherein is their day of salvation. Brother, you better know what it's all about. Boy, you better have a gladness down in your soul and realize, what in the world will someone shout for? Brother, if they can holler and cry when a pigskin goes over the goal line and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of people can holler, how much more should we rejoice in the house of God? In days gone by, they tell me that when D.S. Warner would be preaching and the fire of God would fall, at times there'd be 100 saints in the aisle. They were shouting up and down, and D.S. Warner was heard to say only, "Fire, fire, fire, fire." Such was the glory of God.
Amen.
Praise His holy name.
Amen.
Choir, you may go down. Amen. Glory to God. Boy, our hands never shouted like that before. People at Scott Depot, how can I find words to thank you, dear saints of God? You know we do not use that word much anymore, but when you've been out of the church as long as we have, that word becomes beautiful. Albert has missed having his friends drop in just for a word of prayer. We've been so very grateful for the many prayers that have gone up to our blessed Savior in Al's behalf. It has been a blessing to be with Mort and Naomi. What we would do without our children. I'm sure Oliver has told you what Pop said about sending the musical instruments to your church. He said, "I know they will be used to glorify our Lord." Thank you again and again for your cards, letters, and most of all for your prayers. Love, O.C. Krim. The letter just came this week, and how wonderful it is that we're going to name the gallery the W.A. Krim Gallery. And then here's another letter. "Dear Church, thank you so much for the beautiful Mother's Day cards and the Christian love. Others here..." Now this is Margaret Myers. I better tell you in advance, because this is so precious. She sent us a picture, I want you to see it after church, of her in her new dress beside her new chair. There's Margaret. And you know who she looks like? A very lovely lady in this valley. Mabel Coyner. She looks very much like Mabel. And you'll see it when you see the picture up close. So this will be available down here on the altar after church. "Others here were getting cards from their loved ones, and I shared in their joy. I wasn't dreaming of getting a card." This was for Mother's Day. But praise the Lord, not just one, but 14. And I said, thank you, Jesus. If anyone had passed my apartment, I was praising the Lord and talking out loud, crying for joy and singing. Oh God, it is so good. I got my newsletter, saw my name on the prayer list, and I'm so thankful. I pray for each of you daily. This old body is worn, but oh, I'm so happy in the Lord. A woman here made a picture of me, and I wanted my chair and dress to show. Was disappointed when it didn't all show up, but maybe you can tell how they look. Oh, I can sleep so much better. And I'm still taking tests and went to the doctor yesterday. But God bless each one of you is my prayers. Your sister in Christ, Margaret Myers. Will you put these names where dear ones can see? Well, why don't I just read them? Apparently, these are the persons who sent her Mother's Day cards. Praise ye the Lord, members of the Scott Depot Christ Fellowship, Brother Chase Hill and family, Sister Helen Harper, Brother Raymond Sarah and family, Sister Maxine Post, Sister Loretta Carpenter, Brother Ken Bride and family, Sister Robert Bowers and family, Sister Glenda Pauley and family, Sister Janet Doss, Sister Arlene Wells and family, Sister Eunice McDaniel, Sister Pamela Davis and family, Brother Charles King and family, and Sister Opal Hogue. God bless each one of you for caring. It truly made Mother's Day 1980 one to remember. Others here showing their cards, and I was so happy that these folks remembered them. I shared these with the joy of them. Then here came, I was sharing in the joy of their cards, and then here came all my beautiful cards for my brothers and sisters in Christ. I didn't look for a card and was overjoyed. Apparently she's out of money again because I don't have postage to answer each one right now. But I will someday. Oh, how I love you all. Your sister in Christ, Margaret Myers. So this letter and picture will be down here. Also the letter from Barbara's mother. How wonderful. How blessed. Did you in prayer meeting mention that Sister Vera Wagner's back in the hospital? Please continue to remember her because the infection has come in the operation where the operation took place, and she does need our prayers.
Brother Darrell, could you thank the Lord for this service and for this offering we can bring to our Lord?
Dear Jesus, we thank Thee, Lord, for this another privilege we've had to come into Thy house. We thank You, Lord, for how You've worked and how You've helped through the services this far. We thank You, Lord, for Your anointing, for Your directing hand upon our pastor. We thank You, Lord, for a man of God that is obedient to Thy will. That's about, Lord, and doing what You would have. We thank Thee, Lord, for this church, for these people. We thank You, dear Heavenly Father, for this offering that we're about together. We pray that You would take it, multiply it, and use it for the upbuilding of Thy kingdom. Bless it to the glory of Thy name, we pray, and amen.
Amen. While Brother Larry is testifying, we'll try to close with the young people tonight. And so, Larry, here we are. Young people, would you come and close the service out for us by God's grace?
Well, just sitting over there thinking how good the Lord's been to us. He sure blessed us in this service, and not only this service, but as Pastor Steve was trying to exhort us last night, he's been faithful. Every service I've attended, a little over 4 years since I've been here, God has been faithful every service. And you know, I was just trying to review yesterday a little bit some of the past sermons and sharings on the book. And I don't remember, Pastor, did you share the chapter on sanctification?
Did you share that, Joe?
I believe I did, Larry.
There's one thing you said in there that really kind of got close to me.
Touches my heart, Larry.
You said in there that when we're really hungry for God, then we hardly ever notice the self-denials.
Praise the Lord.
And I just pray that the Lord will help me.
Yeah, but say it again, Larry.
You said that if we're really hungry for God, that when the self-denials come, that we'll hardly ever notice them. I tell you, if I didn't get anything else, trust the Lord will help me.
There's our little message for tonight.
Man, it's a good one.
Boy, really hungry. If we're really hungry for God, we hardly ever notice the self-denials.
Yes.
Amen. Kids, before you sing, Brother and Sister Morgan are going to say a word. Barbara is, we're so glad she's with us tonight. I guess Brother Bob was on his way after his wife, and that's why they're coming back through. So Brother Mike would be so thankful if you'd take the mic to his lovely wife, and she'll speak for our Lord. And, oh, it's such a treasure. See, these two people are so precious that there's hardly words to tell how precious they are. And this gentleman here has taught me more. He spent more time with me, taught me more in the early days when I was trying and in a whirl so much of the time. His words would settle me and give me peace because they were words of wisdom, words of guidance, words of love. And he was able to teach and share with me many, many times. They would come by our home in St. Paris and share with us. And then since we've lived here, by God's wonderful grace, the Morgans have been close friends. And it's just a real wonderful thing to have them here with us tonight. Barbara, praise the Lord.
Well, I want to praise the Lord for being here.
Yes.
And my heart's been stirred in the service by the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
And I'm thankful. And I want to praise the Lord for the songs about heaven.
Amen.
Because most of you know my dad is pretty ill.
Yes.
And I really came home to talk to him about Jesus. Because as far as I knew, he never made a commitment to God.
Yes.
And when I found out he was so ill, I felt like I just had to come to. And I want to praise the Lord that he allowed me to talk with him.
Oh, thank you, Lord.
And I asked him if he loved Jesus, and he said he did. And I said, would you like for him to come into your heart? And he said, yes, I would. And I said, well, we'll just pray and ask Jesus. Because I prayed for a long, long time, Lord, just don't let my father go out without a positive testimony. And then that you'd sing these songs, I don't know how long the Lord will spare him. I want God's will.
Certainly.
In it, because he knows best.
Right.
And so I'm thankful. And there's one other thing that was kind of on my heart.
Wonderful.
When you were sharing about these young people, the little Catholic.
This touches my heart.
Well, praise the Lord.
Yeah.
And coming down here, I had quite a flight. I flew from Indianapolis to Pittsburgh, and it was stormy. So we flew on to Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. We couldn't land in Pittsburgh. And when I got into the airport at Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, there was a Greek lady behind me.
Yeah.
And she talked to me a little bit, and I didn't really promote the conversation, but she just kept staying right with me.
Sure.
And she was from Athens, Greece. And she just talked, and we talked about God, and we talked about the Lord, and how
Amen.
He helped us, you know, in the storm and
yes.
getting there safely.
Yes.
And we just, really, we had fellowship together. And, of course, the first trip to Israel, the Lord witnessed it was important that I go.
Yes.
And I've never have really known, you know, and I don't try to find out, but anyhow, when she said she's from Athens, Greece, and I said, oh, I was in Athens, Greece one time,
yes.
and in Corinth, and told her about going to Israel, and
yes.
of course that made us closer
sure.
you know, together, and we kept talking, and she kept staying with me. It was just as if we were making the trip together.
Wonderful.
And I didn't feel alone,
no.
and she introduced me to her husband.
Yes.
And so then we flew back, and they were in front of me on the airplane, and she kept wanting me to come and sit with her.
Yeah.
But while we were waiting in Harrisburg, I started telling her about you and of how that you taught us that we need to love the Catholic people and the people in these liturgical churches, you know.
Yeah.
And it tore down so many barriers.
Yeah.
And that we just needed to be one. And she said she knew it. And
Amen.
I said, I didn't know anything about the Greek Orthodox Church. And I said, why don't you tell me a little bit about it? I mean, who do you pray to? And she said, oh, we pray to Mary and to God and to Jesus and to the Holy Spirit and to the saints and everybody, she said. And I just really had a good time.
Oh,
with her.
That is so precious.
And I had a voice in the wilderness carrying it with me because
yeah.
I usually when I'm traveling like to take it because you never know, you know, when
right.
God wants you to give it to somebody. And anyway, I still didn't know whether to give it to her. I just couldn't
sure.
Really be sure about it. But I did mention a little bit about Brother Helm, and I showed her his picture. Mm-hmm. And anyhow, when we got into Pittsburgh, they were from Port Allegheny in Pennsylvania.
Yeah.
And so we separated, you know, and... And I was trying to find my plane from Pittsburgh to Charleston. And I thought, well, Lord, I just don't know. I hadn't given them the book. And we're walking through the airport, and I ran right into them again.
Amen.
We just met each other.
Yes.
And I'd already put it to her and her husband written a little note in it. And I said, here, I believe I need to give you this book. And they didn't want to take it. And she said, I don't read English very well, but earlier she told me she had a daughter who graduated from Notre Dame, and she spoke five languages and worked in Washington for the government.
Yeah.
And I said, well, that's all right. Maybe your daughter can read it to you.
Yeah.
So anyway, I don't know if I made the trip for that reason, but anyway, I was able to share, you know, how much you had taught us and caused us to see, because we'd been so prejudiced and... biased in our thinking,
yeah.
and I just told her I wish she knew you.
Oh,
you know, and
I
don't know what will come out of it, but anyway, it seemed to me that maybe I partly made the trip because, you know, like you met the young man in Los Angeles or wherever it was. This is not coincidence when we're in the kingdom.
No,
I know Bob always is bringing this out, you know, that
right.
everything's under control
exactly.
with God.
Yes.
Didn't look like a very good reason for having to come home.
Yes.
But God uses these
yes.
things.
He
and
sure
so
does.
And he took care of me in a wonderful way.
Oh, praise the Lord.
I missed my plane onto Bluefield after I got here, but they put me in Holiday Inn and fed me and
wonderful.
And took me in their limousine. And,
yeah,
and so I was well taken care of because God is faithful.
That's right.
So I just praise him. He
oh,
has been so faithful
Lord,
and so
Barbara.
Wonderful.
Amen.
And we appreciate all you people here. We know that you help to support us, and we're thankful.
And
we've been trying lately. God's put it on my heart to thank him for everybody who supports us.
That's good.
Because they sacrificed to do it.
Man.
And we were just talking before we came to church, we didn't want to have an unthankful heart.
Right.
That we want to be thankful for what Jesus does.
Praise
because
the Lord.
He's been so faithful to
Praise
us.
The Lord.
And we could go on and on and on. Man. What Jesus has done.
Thank you,
he's
Jesus.
Wonderful.
Thank you, Jesus.
I praise
Amen.
His holy name. Yes. He's worthy.
Amen.
And we sure love you all.
We
and
sure
this
love
little
you.
Exhortation here that you gave us a few minutes ago, I just told Kathy was worth coming for. So I'm so thankful, and all of you are so precious, and we love you so much.
Oh, we love
and
you.
I think we met Edith Jordan and Raymond and Pam and them out in the mall list a little earlier, and she said, well, this is what we say about everybody, they're so precious. Well, you are. And so we're
it's
just
true.
Thankful. It's
yeah.
true.
Praise the Lord.
Some of the most wonderful people in
oh,
the world, I do
Jesus.
Believe, by
Thank
God's
you,
grace.
Jesus.
So I just am so thankful to be here, and God's made it possible and that I can be here, that my dad is well enough that I felt like I could
so
come, and still I'm close enough if I need to go back,
yes.
I can.
Oh,
so Jesus
Lord.
Is so wonderful to
Amen.
Us, and I praise His holy name. Amen.
Praise the Lord, Barbara. So thankful. And Brother Bob's going to speak a word also. Oh, my, 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 my. Hallelujah. See, when she spoke about that lady, that's where the Lord operated. By God's grace, it's important to talk to that Greek Orthodox lady.
Wonder.
And Jesus has given us a little part in sharing with Barbara that the Lord would open up a little more, because a lot of times we can't help it. Our backgrounds are such that it's hard to get open to, you see. I had a person say, Brother Ham on Church of God campgrounds. I said, you know, he loves Jesus. I said this 10, 12 years ago. And I said, he loved Jesus. And a woman looked at me and said, I just can't understand if he's God's man, why he's not Church of God. Oh, I said, but he is church. In other words, I can't accept him. He's not Church of God. Well, they wouldn't let him in if he tried. What's he going to do? You know, you're in trouble if you do. Yeah. You're in trouble if you don't. You're caught every way if you go.
Yes.
So there was a prejudice there that if a person wasn't Church of God Anderson, if he wasn't a valid minister. There are Catholics who feel that if a man's not a priest, he's not valid. There are Baptists who feel that if a person's not a Baptist, he's not valid. There's somebody's wrong. You know, somebody's wrong. Can't all be right. But we know that there's one church. The church that Jesus bought with his blood.
Yeah.
And all people that believe in our Lord and repent of their sins belong that church. And they may have doctrines that we can't quite understand. Some are not all right. It's not that we don't endorse and approve wrong doctrine. But if they belong to our Lord, they're our brother and sister.
Yes.
The truth of the matter is, we'll find when we get in glory that many of our doctrines and a lot of our emphases
oh, yes.
have been incorrect.
Yes, sir.
And I've learned this in my ministry. You told me this years ago. A lot of things that we dwelt on as being the most important, we found it wasn't important at all.
True.
And we grew in the faith, you see. Mother said this to me. Mother said this, and she is just astonished at some of the things that she was taught when she was a girl. And then again, she's very glad at some of the things that she's taught. She remembers Sister Scott preaching on some of the things I preached on here. Oh, she sees it in new light and in new joy. So we can appreciate, but not let tradition block us
yes,
from our brothers and sisters.
Yes,
tradition
sir.
Can be valuable. I value. Do you hardly know anybody? I'm pleading new blood, Jesus. But do you hardly know anybody that values tradition more than I do? I mean, everybody's tradition.
Oh, yeah.
Catholic, Calvinist,
yes,
Wesleyan, Baptist, Methodist. I think it's great. I see the hand of God working
yes,
back
sir.
When they get a little light on truth and this would come into existence. But as far as I'm concerned, we need to be shed of that which would keep us, block us from fellowshipping one another.
Yes.
And that's been my joy. And, of course, Brother Helm was a Methodist minister and I was a Church of God minister. It was a joy to get over the fence
yes.
and love him. One
yes.
fellow said, I can't understand. Everybody's not Church of God's in Babylon. I said, well, where was Nehemiah? He was in Babylon. You know, I was just trying to help him out. I said, did God pull him out of, for his thinking that way? I knew that Babylon could be anywhere where God's not leading.
Oh, yeah.
And the Antichrist spirit is anywhere where the Holy Spirit's not in charge. But yeah. I said, wait just a minute, brother. Where was Nehemiah?
Yeah.
I said, he was a man sent from Babylon to Jerusalem.
Well, that hushed the conversation
mm-hmm.
right there. Because my typology was as good as his, or maybe better. But isn't it wonderful that the Lord can flood us above those barriers in love? Because really, the whole point, the whole business of division is rather pointless and ridiculous.
Yes.
And it's a heartbreaking thing to our Lord. And these persons in Greek Orthodox and Catholic, they have seemingly a more open heart to the story of God's servant than do many in Protestantism.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
From Indianapolis to Pittsburgh, I sat with another lady from a holiness church.
Right.
But I tell you, I had more fellowship with that Greek.
Did you hear that?
I did. Yeah. I was more free.
She sat with someone with her background, holiness background, which means Wesleyan.
Now, this was
right
a sweet
there.
Lady. She
yeah,
was
sure.
a precious lady.
But you had more fellowship with a Greek Orthodox.
I was more free to talk about God and the Lord and the things of the kingdom.
I've seen it work out.
Uh-huh. Yeah. I really was.
I'm glad you pointed that out.
And another thing that maybe this hasn't ended, I don't know, but this man has a nephew in Warsaw, Indiana, and one in Plymouth, Indiana. And see, they're right there where we're looking.
That's right on your doorstep.
It is.
Yeah, praise the Lord.
So maybe it hasn't ended. I don't know.
Could be, by God's grace.
Praise the Lord.
Yes, sir.
Glory.
Hallelujah.
Oh, this is good. This is good. Well, I was just thinking, brother, I love this church so much. I'm so thankful for your... let's see, who said this? Didn't Brother Helm say it? Dr. Paul Reese one time was talking about Stephen being flexibly in touch with the Holy Spirit. That is, he said he was a man that God could do one thing with him one day, turn around and do something almost the opposite the next day. See, he's flexible, and that's the beauty that I see here is this flexibility. Now, if you get rigid, brother, the Holy Spirit will still help you as much as... Missions are fine, but God may want to go beyond them, outside of them.
Yes, sir.
And I tell you, of course, Brother Everett and I here, we're getting up in years. Our hair's getting gray in that. But I tell you, the older I get, the more I marvel. I begin to wonder, Lord, I wonder how I even know who's in the kingdom. Of course, I used to know. I mean, I used to feel like I knew.
Sure.
I thought,
sure.
Brother, if you were just down my church and my doctrine and everything, I could tell you. But now I'm beginning to wonder, Lord, dear Lord, who is in the kingdom?
Amen.
I wonder if I even know.
That is so good.
I was thinking like her father here, for instance. He's 86 years of age, never gone to church. And he's been like a lot of men, drink some and so forth and so on. He doesn't anymore, but he did. And according to a lot of people, now he doesn't know anything about God or anything. But when it comes somebody talking around the house about peace, he said, now wait a minute, we don't want to talk about, shouldn't talk about people.
Think of that.
See? Not profess to be Christian, and yet he knows things that we Christians are trying to get a hold of. Well, he's preaching it.
Amen. Amen.
And a man that works, he's been working down at a horse barn there. He's 86, been going down there evenings working. And the man that hired him some, 10 years ago maybe, he said, I didn't want to hire him because he was an old man. He said, I thought you can't tell an old man what to do. And he'd have his own mind. But he said, since I worked with him these 10 years, he said, he's been the most lovable, fine man to work with. He
Amen.
Said, he does everything I tell him.
Amen.
And I thought, here's some Christian principles in a man. Dear Lord Jesus,
true.
I want to judge a man by his theology and whether he measures up to certain standards, but here's the kingdom of God. I tell you, God reaches out and blesses men, gets a hold of men, saves men, and uses men.
Boy,
that I didn't even know they were Christians. But God uses them and blesses them. So
I'm
thankful
good,
for your
Bob.
Flexibility. That
praise
is beautiful
Lord
to behold.
For his love.
And
praise.
I love you. And
oh, we love you, Brother Bob. Oh, Brother Bob. I wanted to say that Dr. Newberry said of you that your ministry in the Church of God had been proven because you outlasted all other evangelists and would still be in evangelism today had it not been for a change in the nature of his ministry, pastoring the Mentone Fellowship there. But Dr. Newberry said that of you. He said that Bob has proved his ministry because most men are in and out. They're in as long as they can get enough money to go, and then they're out. This is what's happened through the years. But he said Bob Morgan has stayed in the ministry, in evangelism. And that proved something to Brother Newberry. I was thankful for that. Yes, sir. Indeed. Yes, sir. Bring our mic back.
You don't know how I was blessed with that prayer book. See, now I was never brought up on that.
What?
Oh, I used to think if a man read a prayer, but that was terrible. Oh, that was awful if he read a prayer. But I tell you, I've come to realize some of these great prayers I mentioned.
Ruth, do you recognize
that? I want to get one of those, brother. Yeah,
that's Ruth's prayer book. This is an Episcopal prayer group book. And when I went to the Episcopalian church, I had a friend. You had a pastor there from England in time past, St. Timothy's. And when I went down, I said, oh, my dear brother, would it be possible for you to get me one of these? And so this was given to me by an Episcopal priest. And out of this, I also gave you one day a lovely service of the churching of the women after the child was born. We had that. And if anybody was with us, we've never had a service like that before since. When Linda came after her child had been born, before she ever brought her child for dedication, and we knelt and used the old Anglican service, which is not in the new prayer book. I have the new one also, Ruth. I'm a slight bit partial to this one. It has ancient beauty. Now, I like the new one too. But, oh, this is so dear. And I have it. See, my family, I love and want to teach my family some of the prayers for the family. I'd like for us to stand at the balcony before we go to our separate rooms and repeat the prayers, certain short prayers of blessing before nightfall and blessing in the morning. They're great. This is a great old book. This comes out of the book that John Wesley used. For basically, it's an Anglican prayer book. And that's it, Brother
Just
Bob.
Just wanted to tell you,
your
I comment's
interesting.
The fact that you can enjoy a prayer that's read. See, if God's in it, the important thing is whether God's in it. You can say a prayer without a prayer book God's not in, or you can read one that God's in. Now,
both
it doesn't
ways.
Mean reading it is or isn't of God. It's
both
whether
ways.
Or not God's in it.
Rather
than if God's in it. But some of these prayers are beautiful.
Oh.
The wording is just...
Oh, beautiful. Praise the Lord. Oh, we're glad, Brother Rob. So he can have the floor as long as he can stay up, because you and I are the beneficiaries by God's wonderful grace. Praise His holy name. Oh, merciful God, grant that like as Christ died and rose again, so this child may die to sin and rise to newness of life. Grant that all sinful affections may die in him, and that all things belonging to the Spirit may live and grow in him. Grant that, and this morning it was she may have power and strength to have victory, and to triumph against the devil, the world, and the flesh. Grant that whosoever is here dedicated to thee by our office and ministry may also be endued with heavenly virtues and everlastingly rewarded through thy mercy, O Lord God, who dost live and govern all things, world without end. Amen. Tozer said, they're beautiful. And they have been given to the church for centuries. Why should we be without them? Let us have freedom that we may pray extemporaneously, preach, as I did this morning without notes at all. But let us also remember our great past. And this is a part of our great past. Praise the Lord. Oh, yes, Ruth. Did you hear her? Oh, pray. Yeah. She said that she had never heard it read more beautifully and with more feeling. See, we discovered years ago, Barbara can remember when I started reading the prayer book. I said, oh, listen to this. Oh, let me read you this prayer. Oh, let me read you this dedication. Oh, let me read you this. I believe if God can help our people, I can use that in church sometime.
Yes.
And so, through the years, I've treasured the great treasure of the church. I have a Catholic prayer book also. I've read to you out of it. Sometimes when you didn't know anything about it. because I didn't know who all had had enough light on the subject not to be bothered by it. So I just came and read. Oh, I read a prayer one day. Oh, it was an old ancient prayer of Augustine or Anselm, and I hit out of here, and somebody met me back there and was crying. They said, "Oh, Brother Ho, bless God, that's the best prayer you've ever prayed in your life." I said, "Well, give the credit to Augustine or Anselm," I said. And I didn't tell them I read it out of it was out of Marlene's Catholic prayer book. But, and they've gotten me one, the children, Pam and Gary, got me one. And I find things in there that are great. So you see, sometimes being non-denominational can be a great blessing. Whereas we don't have a bishop calling us to task, we can also appreciate, you see, the great heritage that the anointed bishops have given us. Because they've been great men that have written these kind of things. Praise the Lord. Lord, we thank you for this, and thank you for the privilege of being in a fellowship where I can bring the prayer book in. Oh, I've been so blessed. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you that this gives us a tie with Wesley and with Whitfield and with the great, great priests, archbishops of years gone by. Men like C.S. Lewis use this every Sunday, and we fellowship with those men. Even today, through thy word. Amen. Oh, did you see what happened? We're pretty happy up here. Because when she started telling her testimony, there's where it witnessed on the meeting with the Greek Orthodox lady. Then that led her precious husband to expound on us a little bit. Here we're talking about this. Sally feels led to pick this. Oh, she asked me which should be. I said, "No man an island first, by God's grace, then the one that's to follow." And after we've discussed all that, then we get the beautiful truths of this great. What God is saying is that He has led us to declare this. what God is saying is that this is important. He's been trying to do this with his ministers down through the years. And I was just thinking that there was somebody running up and down these roads telling that we're a cult. One of the signs of the cult, we point proudly to the fact that we love orthodoxy. We point proudly in the right way to the fact that we appreciate the Apostles' Creed and we do not put down the church. We point carefully to the fact that we do not believe that we're the only ones. In fact, we're only a small part of the great church. And I may also say this, a cult has a very feeling that it's just them and nobody else, pushing everybody else out. As far as I know, there's no cultish attitude here at all. As far as I can tell, there isn't. Instead, we embrace the great Church of God Universal. See, just the opposite. Isn't this something that people would travel the roads and say, just the opposite? We're about as far away from that as a person can get. And yet, that's the story that's being told. But we're just trusting Jesus. Only God can fight our battles. I said to Stephen on the telephone, I said, Stephen, I just can't hardly believe it. And yet I can. Because if God has taught us a little bit along this line, the devil's going to fight it awful hard. What if the barriers really fall? And in churches and in through the valley, men can realize that they are not an island. And they defend their brother and defend their friends. What could really happen? Something wonderful. Praise the Lord. Did I? Yes, surely.
I wish I had spoken before they sang. The Lord was dealing with me. But this tonight's service has been the most wonderful experience of expression of Jesus' individual attention to each person.
That's good, Sharon.
The individual needs of each person.
I ask him for that in the prayer room, choir room.
And then they would sing. The very thing that we need is we can't stand alone. We need each other.
That's right.
We need to love each other like Jesus loves us. And
yes.
When we love, then we have everybody else's needs on our heart.
Yes.
And we rejoice with each other. And we're concerned with each other's concerns.
Yes. Yes.
And where could a church this size, people stand and express the desires of their hearts or the help that Jesus has given them, like it's been done here tonight?
I just enjoyed it. It just helped us so much. You see, when God's working through the congregation, we're getting as much out of that as some formal presentation. Have you noticed that many times on Sunday night, it's just impossible to preach? Why? Because God's bringing messages of love and sharings to the people. We have a formal sermon on Sunday morning, a fairly formal service for evangelicals, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's fairly formal. And it's so blessed.
But it's personal.
Very.
It's formal.
It is formal. Personal. That's right, it is.
But it's still personal.
Yes.
To each individual.
Right. Praise the Lord.
And I was just so thankful that anybody can express a need.
Oh, yes.
Or share something that they're happy about.
Yes.
And everybody appreciates it. We aren't sitting around patronizing each person waiting for them to get done like would be done in some services.
No.
We're happy to hear what they have
to
say. And I'm just real thankful.
Praise the Lord, I'm thankful to you. There are things on hearts, even as on John Sandy's, that will wait for other services. Some very bright, some very beautiful hearts are burning brightly. We're just trusting. But I marvel that God has taught you all to be very careful. I haven't had a problem. Jesus, I'm pleading the blood. I may have it before the month's out. Let's just put it this way. Lest the devil fight. I want to be very thankful that God has taught you carefulness. And because, see, were we to pray, there'd be maybe be 200 who'd have something on their heart. Yet, as far as I can tell, those who have spoken have been ordered by God. And that has helped us so much. Boy, it just makes it so wonderful, so restful up here. Now, this next song is personal. It doesn't say we, it says I, right? I am a child of God. It's our closing number.
Praise
guys, thank you for holding your voices up there. Hallelujah. We may stand. Let us stand together. Remember, tomorrow's a holiday, so by God's grace, most of you, for at least tomorrow, might have to get up early, and I've been a little more relaxed about the service running this late tonight. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Bless your wonderful heart. May the Lord give you a blessed day tomorrow. Praise His holy name. So thankful. I've thought of you in the last few days, the last few weeks. Wondered when you might be speaking again. Yeah.
Boy, and you so wait for that.
That's so precious, dear one.
I was just wanting to praise the Lord.
Yeah,
I wouldn't
amen.
Talk too much.
Praise the Lord. That's good.
I sure love His church. You know, the devil, he does his little bit to fight. But, oh, I'm so encouraged. He can just go ahead and do his little bit. That's all right. But I am so encouraged. And you know that pastor over there, Pastor Bob, I've been wanting to see him for about 6 or 7 months.
Yeah.
So I'm so thrilled to see him.
Oh, this is good.
But he said that there are some people that, you know, in the kingdom, he didn't even know, you know, they have such wisdom. I tell you, it amazes me, the people that has wisdom about God that they don't even know. One of them's my husband.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm telling you, my children's with me tonight. He's starting to realize that, you know, we've got to have help.
Yeah.
We've got to help for our children.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it might be realizing a little late, but I'm thankful. And I mean, he's getting an insight on, you know, the kingdom. And it's amazing. He doesn't realize, you know, what's going on.
Yeah.
But I know what's, you know, of course I've been trying to tell him, but, you know, sometimes we just have to keep loving and just have patience, you know, with our loved ones. But God's helping him to see.
Amen.
You know,
That's good.
That we're weak. We can't do anything.
That's right.
We can't do a thing.
Right.
We just got to trust and turn it over to the Lord. And he's starting to realize, well, you know, I don't care how much you fuss and holler, it won't change nothing.
No.
So we gotta have help. So I got my children here. It might be a little rough that way, but I'm trusting.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
That's
sure
so
love
sweet.
You, brother.
We love you. I marvel that God would bring you to us and give you freedom and rest and peace so that you'd be able to speak when God calls upon you to, because it is a great blessing. It's a miracle. I know this is true. You see, she feels at home. This is her place. And yeah. Amen. Yeah, she feels at home here. Glory. No, but this is where God's presence. Amen. Praise the Lord. This is a tribute to Jesus. Praise the Lord. So thankful. Hallelujah. John, what was the title of your song? John Sandy, where are you? Where's John Sandy? What was the title of that?
My Mind Forgets a Million Things.
My Mind Forgets a Million Things. That was the title of it? Oh, that's an unusual title. That's good. But it says something about the day that I met you.
In the chorus?
Yeah.
But all the days I ever knew are measured by my love for you. There's several endings. I'm not quite sure. Really.
Okay. Are measured by my love for you. I just wanted to put that in my mind. It was so wonderful. I've not forgotten. John, didn't think the second time you sung it was even better than the first. By God's wonderful grace. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. John, you want a title? No Man is an Island. That's the theme of the service. John will be coming to my study door if I don't tell him now. Some of these tapes that have no formal preaching have wonderful things in them. This is a very special tape. No man is an island. Praise the Lord. All right, I want to do something that's scriptural.
Instead of having closing prayer, I want to do what the scriptures say that the Lord did with his disciples. It said that he sang a hymn and went out. And so I wonder what that hymn might be. That's what we're going to do last as a congregation. Does anybody have a hymn on their heart? Oh, who said that? Walter? Murray Joe? That's it. Wonderful. Well, we're going to sing that one and go out. Isn't that wonderful? Glory to God. All right. Boy, that's it. This is what we begin with this morning. It just struck my mind like that. We're opening and closing with amazing grace. Through many dangers, toils, and snares. Through many dangers, toils, and snares. I don't want to quit because is there something else to amazing grace words? Praise God. And then we'll try to go. All right. Praise God. 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 Praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God. You're dismissed in Christ's name.
They were requesting me to come up and the congregation remember his wife, Judy, in prayer tonight.
Okay. Would you take that with you as you go? We don't want to fail this. Pray for Judy as you go, and don't forget. Would you? Praise the Lord.